See, we have already completed more chapters from this book. We've done Ailing Planet also. We did Ailing Planet. Yeah, we did it during, I think, the vacations also. And I think so what, Discovering Tut also we have done. Right? So the first three, four chapters are there. I'll tell you the syllabus also. I had a... Yeah, online classes we did. Never mind, we'll do it again because it is in the next term. So whatever is in the next term, we'll have to go through it again, isn't it? So that is not much of an issue. So I think so, Landscape of the Soul, this is the last chapter for this term from this book. And then we proceed to the next book. So next week, we all should be ready with our snapshots. Okay, right. So we continue with this chapter. So if you remember what I discussed yesterday, what is the main difference about between the Chinese paintings and the European paintings? Yes, yeah, so European, it's a realism. It's a likeness. And Chinese is about a spirituality. It's about the essence, right? And in which painting would you find empty space in Chinese? What is the significance of that emptiness? So I have shared with you pictures of paintings, a number of pictures I've shared with you of Chinese paintings and European. The difference is very visible. Difference is very visible from the detailing which is there in the European painting. Yeah, so they are there. So whether it's a landscape, you know, so the landscape, it is not necessarily focusing on the minute elements here. It is that, okay, they have made, they've given us an idea. Okay, so there are clouds also, there's a house also. Or right, and it is there, who completes it? That emptiness, we are there to complete it. The viewer is going to complete it, and you take your own viewpoint and try to understand what is it. So it's entirely your vision and how you want to. But when we talk about the likeness over there, he just wants you to like see, this is what I have replicated. Okay, right? Then we talk about here, there is a balance in the Chinese art, as it is we see the balance in the culture also. So the balance there, like we call about the shan shui, the elements which are there, the major elements in the landscape, mountain, water. Then there is the balance of the masculinity and the feminism, right? Yes, yeah, so the yin and the yang, right? So the horizontal, you can say it is the land surface, the rivers, the grass, and of course we have the mountains and the clouds and all. Yeah, so that is the, right, the yin. Okay, right. And now let us see here. Let us read this paragraph once again. So the two elements of an image, these represent two complementary poles reflecting the Taoist view of the universe. So Taoist, we had read about Wu Daozi. That means to show the way and how the painter wanted to show the way to the emperor. The mountain is Yang, reaching vertically towards heaven, stable, warm and dry in the sun. The water is Yin, horizontal and resting on the earth. So we have, you know, like the balance is there, right? For everything that is very strong, everything that has that heat, there is something which has that coolness, that calmness, that you can say, yeah, right, to counterpart that, to equalize it. And I have shared the video also where the symbol of the yin and the yang is shared, isn't it? So we have the white one with a black dot on it, and there's a black one with a white dot on it. So that balance is there, isn't it? And now these two important elements are essential in life also. So without that, what will happen? There'll be an imbalance, right? So just think about it. Of course, if there were no water, you have your rivers and the grass and all, what will happen? So there will be an imbalance, right? So the interaction of yin, the feminine aspect of universal and energy, and its counterpart yang, active and masculine, is also a function or a fundamental notion of Taoism. What is often overlooked is an essential third element, the middle void where their interaction takes place. So if you look at the paintings which I've shared with you, you see that middle void, you see that emptiness. That is where the interaction it takes place. This can be compared with the yogic practice of pranayama, breathe in, retain, breathe out. The suspension of breath is the void where meditation occurs. So where we stop breathing for a while, we hold our breath. That is when meditation, right? Not like this. You don't, not for the seconds you hold your breath. So you just, it's very natural. You're breathing in, and this is the moment you hold it, and then you let it out. Can you feel it? You can try it if you want to. Not in a hurry, go relaxed way. Take a breath in and out. So do you just release it immediately? No. So you take a time. There's that moment, that second, that is the what? Middle void. Now here, it is, what is the middle void? It is essential. Nothing can happen without it. It is very important for that interaction to take place. Hence the importance of the white unpainted space in Chinese landscape. And also because that unpainted space is what the viewer can see. What is it that the painter wants to show? Right? He's telling you there, you can take your own direction and have a look at it. This is also where man finds a fundamental role. In that space between heaven and earth, he becomes a conduit of communication between the poles of the universe. So man is there connecting heaven and earth. That is why man is an essential component of the landscape. His presence is essential, even if it's only suggested. So necessary that he has to be a part, he has to be shown there, but he has just a suggestion of his presence there, okay? And far from being lost or oppressed by the lofty peaks, he is, in Francois Chang's wonderful expression, the eye of the landscape. Just like there was the eye of the dragon would be incomplete and the painter had to fear the dragon fly away if you made the eye. So the eye of the landscape, who is the eye of the landscape? Man is the eye of the landscape. He completes it. Now this was about, we have about people who have been trained in art. People have made lots of efforts there. You know, they keep practicing and they've done apprenticeship maybe also under gifted painters. We have people who have a sense of style or a sense of judgment. So they are able to put up things together, randomly arrange things. They're able to just kind of rearrange everything in a very nice, orderly manner. So come to think of it, yes, we also, when it comes to arranging our homes or when it comes to arranging, you know, like our rooms also, we have a vision and we are able to put things in a nice way. So when your house is there, put your mask up and wear your mask properly also, Krish. So when everything is arranged in a nice, orderly way, so sometimes we also feel, oh my God, I'm so gifted. Look how nice I've made everything look. So when you put flowers in a certain way in an arrangement, that is also, so everybody has a different vision to do things, right? So even a simple presentation, you've made a tasty dish, but you are there, you put it in a very, you can say, simple bowl. But if you put the same thing nicely presented on a nice tray and you use your nice crockery and everything, so the presentation, it becomes even better, isn't it? So that sense of aesthetics, everybody has. We all have that sense of aesthetics. So whether it is the way you dress up, you know, okay, I want this color to go with that. So some way or the other, we all have that. But people who go beyond that, things that are ordinary. Have you all visited Rock Garden, Chandigarh? Have you been there? Yes. What is so unique about it? The lake there? You don't remember the garden? What? Why? What is the garden, the Rock Garden about? Yes. So it is, discarded things there, right? Nowadays, we talk about recycling and everything like that. So you, who created Rock Garden? Naik Chand. He made that garden and all the discarded bits, everything that was lying around. And just see how beautifully he has made that. All the images that he has made, the animals and the figurines, everything there. So all that, the bangles have been used. You have the crockery which has been broken, right? So you have so many things which have been used there. And he has made it very presentable. Otherwise, lying there, it would just have been a pile of garbage. But he has used it again, right? So now just look at this here, getting inside outsider art. What is outsider art? When French painter Jean Dubuffet mooted the concept of art brut in the 1940s, the art of the untrained visionary, art brut, people who are not trained in art, but still they have a vision, they have an eye, was of minority interest. From its almost veiled beginnings, outsider art has gradually become the fastest growing area of interest in contemporary art internationally. And surprisingly, nowadays, people are more interested in outsider art than in what trained professionals are presenting, right? So we have people there, you will see there, almost in the newspaper, almost of Saturday also, they have this picture of various sculptures. You have people putting up these utensils together and making an art form out of it, right? So you have nowadays you have your recycled bottles and all, and you're making something out of it, right? So this is, there you have a vision. Plastic also. Then what about this sand artist, you see? Yes, so right, but that of course, just see that is such a beautiful medium or a beautiful way of expression. So for every occasion, every moment, there is this sand art that has been created. Yeah, so he's got there. Yes, and India's got talent also. Now, this genre, okay, their works are a stimulating contrast to a list of mainstream offerings. Around the time Dubuffet was propounding his concept, in India, an untutored genius was creating paradise. And during the same time, when people were talking about art brut, there was a genius in India, an untutored one. Untutored, did not have any training. Years ago, the little patch of jungle that he began clearing to make himself a garden. See where rock garden is now, it was a jungle. He cleared it himself and he made that garden. Just see what a beautiful vision he had. And he was not trained in all this, but he was able to, and it looks as if, wow, as if landscaping was done and there was a plan for it and everything was made to perfection, right? So the little patch of jungle that he began clearing to make himself a garden, sculpted with stone and recycled material, is known in the world today as the rock garden at Chandigarh. See, you've all seen these figurines over there. So when you go to rock garden, I think so when you visit Chandigarh, so rock garden, it has to be on our list, isn't it? It is always there. If you have not seen it once, you have to go and have a look at it. So all these figurines there, animals have been made, and so many things of birds there, of these broken, you can say bangles and crockery and all these things there that have been discarded. Its 80-year-old creator-director, Nechand, is now hailed as India's biggest contributor to outsider art. So he is there. When you talk about outsider art, so Nechand is the person who has contributed the most. And he is there. When you talk about him, it's the first name that comes. The 50th issue, Spring 2005 of Raw Vision, a UK-based magazine pioneer in outsider art publications, features Nechand and his rock garden sculpture, Women by the Waterfall, on its anniversary issues cover. So this is it there. So then if you go there, there's actually a waterfall and all the creations are there, right? So see, he was featured internationally also on this magazine. So not only nationally is known, but internationally is recognized as the face of outsider art. So what is art brut? The notion of art brut or raw art was of works that were in their raw states as regards cultural and artistic influences. So when you look at paintings, oh, that's a finished product, so wonderfully done. Anything and everything from a tin to a sink to a broken down car could be material for a work of art. So for anything can be used. Like he's used broken sinks also, he's used broken glasses and cups and plates, anything he has picked up. And anybody can do that. Anybody who has an eye for aesthetics, an eye for arranging things, an eye to create beauty, right? So Nechand has taken to dizzying heights. recognizing his art as an outstanding testimony of the difference a single man can make when he lives his dream. So there is there, you know, like, yeah, one person there. He's so dedicated, he can realize. The Swiss Commission for UNESCO will be honoring him by way of a European exposition of his works. So in Europe also his works will be shown, okay? The 5-month interactive show Realm of Nature beginning October will be held at leading museums in Switzerland, Belgium, France, and Italy. The biggest reward is walking through the garden and seeing people enjoy my creation, Nekchand says. And of course, this essay was written in the year 2005, and it's been a long time since then. And Nekchand, he passed away a couple of years, the creator of this garden. Okay, so can we go to the questions now? Can we go to the questions? So this is your homework, and I'll come to know how many of you are actually understood and were attentive during the chapter. Should I conduct a speaking skill on this chapter? So please go through this. You know this. So contrast the Chinese view of art with the European view. You can do that. Explain the concept of Shan Shui. Shan Shui is mountain water, that the landscape has both the elements to create that balance. Now, what do you understand by the terms outsider art and art brut or raw art? They're the same. And of course, here it is people who have a vision for art and they're using things which have been, like, of course, they're untutored people who create works of art. Who is the untutored genius who created a paradise? And what is the nature of his contribution to art? Who was the untutored genius? It was Nekchand, right? Now, the emperor may rule over the territory he has conquered, but only the artist knows the way within. Absolutely. The artist knows the reality. The artist knows the way of life because the artist shows us the reality. Artist shows us how the people live, about the work, the way they work in the fields, or they're making the crafts or pottery, whatever they're doing. That is the artist's strength. Now, yes, the landscape is an inner one, a spiritual and a conceptual space. Which one are we talking about? We're talking about Chinese art over here. Which landscape? The landscape which is presented, it is something which is an idea, a thought. It is not a figure. It is not, you can say, an object, but it is an idea. Okay? Right. Now, let's come here. Look at these words here. Panel, studio, brush, essence, material. These words have more than one meaning. What are the different ways in which we can use the word panel? Like, yes, the apprentice drew a fly on the panel. Panel of wood on that panel, right? What else here? Panel, what is the panel? What else can be used here? What else does panel mean? The panel of judges, the panel of experts, right? Yes. Studio. Studio is the only way your photography, you go for your photograph. So studio is also an artist's workplace, is also studio. Yes. Brush. Painting brush. What else? Okay, now you're going to see all the brushes. So paintbrush, toothbrush, right? All that. So we have the brush. Yeah, a close brush with death, right? So just escaped it narrowly, okay? Right, so brush also too. Like you can see the cat brushed by me, touching you, leaving you, touching you, going near you. Essence, what is essence? The essence is not the smell. Essence, okay, like you have your vanilla essence like you use in cooking in your... Yes, to change, to give that. Essence is also the extract. Essence is also the extract of something. Like, what is the essence of this chapter? What is the essence of life? Right? So what is it? You extract it. You just talk about it in a few words, the meaning of that. That is essence. Material. Material as in the material used for this desk is of very good quality. Right? It's a material world, materialistic world, isn't it? Right? So yes, so we have here the different ways in this can be used, right? So you can make more sentences using the same words. Fine. Yeah, so I think so with this, we have come to an end to this chapter.